Hello and welcome everybody to today's LinkedIn Live. Today we're doing a very special Black History Month LinkedIn Live, and I'm excited to talk to our very special and successful guest, Lieutenant General retired Charles W. Hooper. So thank you for coming today, General.
Glad to be here with you, Rich.
Great, thank you. I joked a little bit before the podcast here about the fact that I didn't want to read his whole bio. So I'm going to just give a little short mention of a little bit of what's going on, what's been going on with General Hooper, and then we can get into some questions. So if you haven't run into General Hooper throughout your military career, he has held senior level military political positions around the world during a 41-year military career. He's recently joined the Cohen Group as a senior counselor. He most recently served as the Director of Defense Security Cooperation Agency, which does a ton of work with U.S. weapons and the military equipment around the world. So I'm not going to go into all the details, but I want to get some of that out now. But again, thank you so much for joining me here today. I'm really excited to share with our audience a very successful person and kind of pick your brain a little bit about how you feel that success came to you and how you were supported throughout your journey. So I guess the first thing I'll ask you is, how did your personal background and experience shape your approach to leadership and service?
Well, thanks so much for the question. And it's great to be here with everybody to have an opportunity to talk to you. So in many ways, Rich, my story is a very American story. My family's originally from New York City. And some live in New Jersey, as far away as New Jersey, right? From New York, but we're New Yorkers. I come from an extended family, a village, if you will, of very patriotic veterans. So most of them in those days, the males in my family were Korean and Vietnam War veterans. When they came back from their service, some stayed in the military, but some, when they came back to their service, they came back to New York City, and I come from a family of New York City policemen and firemen. So they all came back from the war. They were veterans transitioning, and I guess we'll talk a little bit about that later. And they ended up in the 1950s being in the first really large tranche of Black Americans who took the civil service exam and joined the New York City Fire Department and the New York City Police Department. But it was not only the males in my family, the women in my family that I grew up around were all public servants. They were teachers. They were teachers' aides. There were registered nurses. My aunt was one of the first Black registered nurses at Harlem Hospital in New York City. Wow. And they were teachers, educators. They all succeeded despite some of the obstacles that were placed in their way in those days. And they inspired me and the young people of my generation to do the same. Excellence was expected. Achievement was expected. Excuses were not accepted for that. And many of them were involved in the civil rights movements in the 1960s. And it was assumed when we were growing up, having these people from mentors, parents, and role models, that we would work hard and succeed, and not only succeed, but we would serve our community as well. That was just the expectation. So, you know, as I went on and I was fortunate enough to attend West Point, I was fortunate enough to do my graduate work at Harvard. These things were not exceptional in the circles that I grew up in. In fact, they were expected of you to achieve and to stand on the shoulders of giants who made sacrifices and to move the families forward. I knew early that I wanted to be a leader and a public servant, and I wanted to make a difference. And the reason for that was the people I saw all around me were making a difference every day. I mean, it's hard not to want to serve the public when your dad is a New York City fireman, right? And you know, when other people are rushing away from burning buildings, he's rushing into burning buildings. And so it wasn't any surprise growing up around these veterans and going up around these public servants, I chose to go to the United States Military Academy at West Point. Why? Because they told me that was the best leadership school to go to.
I'll agree with you there.
Good man. And so I wanted to go there, and they told me it produced the best leaders, and I knew, of course, about the history of the school and the distinguished graduates of the school, President Eisenhower, President Grant, and the list and the long gray line goes on and on. So that's where I wanted to go, and that's what I wanted to do. And the last thing I'd mention is they were very adamant about not allowing yourself to be discouraged by the many negative voices that there are out there. They were very much in the realm of you will not take any notice of those who will try to discourage you. You will succeed and you will keep moving forward. So that's the kind of background I grew up in. It was always positive, always encouraging. And I think that honestly, that was one of the principal factors in the blessings that I've enjoyed in my professional and personal life was the family and the village I grew up in.
No, I think that's huge. And I really appreciate that, the understand the background and listen, even if people are in the position now that everyone's watching you, right? No matter where you're at, who, what stage of your life, you're being watched by someone. And so setting that example obviously did a lot for you and your family. And it's been amazing to see that. And, you know, I love now that there's so much, so many movies and such that are out there now that talks about some of the struggles and how people overcame. I love watching those type of movies to see and not, you know, I have no idea how some people have dealt with things, and it's great to see how they persevered. But yeah, you kind of have that positive image along the way, which really is important. I think it's huge. So thank you for that. I love listening to that. You know, as we celebrate Black History Month, how do you think the recognition and understanding of Black history contributed to you as a military leader?
Well, I got to tell you, I told you about my family and how they aspire to overcome some of the obstacles and some of the challenges that they faced. But I was very fortunate because in my family, we were steeped and just enveloped in African-American history and the contributions that Black Americans made to building this great nation that we have, even though it wasn't taught in school. So I was very lucky. You know, as a boy, my father grew up in Harlem, okay, in New York City. And as a boy, my father spent his afternoons and evenings, his mother and father were working very hard. He could have been running around in the streets and doing things, but he discovered the Schoenberg Center for Research in Black Culture. And for those of you who are not New Yorkers, the Schoenberg, what used to be the Schoenberg Collection in New York, was one of the first repositories of Black history, Black American history in the United States. And it's still there. And I go back occasionally just to stop by because they have exhibitions and these types of things. But anyway, he grew up with a love of reading and he shared this history with me. So I grew up with stories about, you know, African-American and Black contributions in the arts, in the sciences. I grew up hearing stories about Scott Joplin and Louis Armstrong and Duke Ellington and the foundations of the purest American musical art form, that's jazz, which became blues, which became rock and roll, which became Motown and everything else. I grew up knowing people who actually used to go to the Cotton Club, okay? And the history that was made at the Cotton Club, where Duke Ellington really perfected the American musical art form. I grew up hearing stories about people who actually knew Josephine Baker, the Toast of Paris, African-American woman who became the Toast of Paris and the Toast of France. I grew up with people who had actually read Langston Hughes' poems and the great authors of the Harlem Renaissance. And I was introduced to that by my family and my greater circle of friends. And in the military realm, because I grew up with these veterans, I mean, you talk sometimes about these movies they're making now that are recognizing some of the contributions that African-Americans have made and the challenges they've overcome, like Hidden Figures and these others. Well, I grew up hearing stories about the Buffalo Soldiers on the Western Plain, the 9th and 10th U.S. Cavalry, 24th and 25th Infantry. I grew up with hearing stories about them on the frontier and charging up San Juan Hill with Teddy Roosevelt. I grew up with stories about the Harlem Hellfighters, the 369th Infantry Regiment out of Harlem, spent more time in the lines in World War I than any other American regiment. but unfortunately had to fight with the French because they weren't allowed to fight with the American Expeditionary Force. Produced several Medal of Honor winners. Fort Polk, Louisiana is now Fort Johnson, Louisiana, named after one of the Harlem Hellfighters. I grew up with stories about Eugene Bullard, the Black Swallow of Death, African-American fighter pilot, couldn't fly with the Americans, but flew with the French. When Charles de Gaulle came on a state visit to visit President Kennedy, he asked specifically to meet with Eugene Bullard. And I knew people that knew that he was an elevator operator at Rockefeller Center after this distinguished career in World War I. And he was right there. The Today Show, as a matter of fact, it's a bit of a story. When Charles de Gaulle asked about this person, no one in the American government had a clue who he was. Okay, of course, he was a French hero. They're looking for this guy to interview him, and NBC's looking for him, and it turns out he's an elevator operator in 30 Rock in the NBC headquarters. And so they interview him, and they talk about his career as a World War I fighter pilot. I grew up, of course, knowing about Brigadier General Benjamin O. Davis and the Tuskegee Airmen of World War II, but also the 761st Tank Battalion, you know, General Patton's Black Panthers. Morgan Freeman just did a great special that they're showing on the History Channel about the 761st Tank Battalion. I grew up learning about the women of the 6th 888 Postal Battalion, an all African-American female organization who, cleared out the tons of mail that was waiting for soldiers in the European theater. They cleared all that out and kept the mail going, all African-American unit. And then on and on and on. And so I grew up with these stories. And so I wasn't, you know, I wasn't under the illusion that we had not contributed, we as African Americans had not contributed to the strength, the wealth, the cultural richness of this country. But I was also aware of the fact that I was being given opportunities that they did not have, and that I was standing on the shoulders of giants, and I had an obligation. I had a responsibility to take the opportunities that they fought so hard for and to move forward and to demonstrate that their sacrifices were not in vain. So I spent a little time on this history, but it's so important because it gave me a sense of pride and it gave me a sense of who I was and where I fit into the great American experiment.
I think that was great. By the way, I'm going to rewind this and watch it several times, take notes so I can go do some of this research on my own. This is some great stories. I really appreciate that. And yeah, and I was going to ask you, but you brought it up, you know, just feeling that obligation of kind of having to pass it on, because, you know, we live in an era now where the information moves so fast that it seems like, you know, you don't want people to forget about some of these giants that and great stories. And as you mentioned, you feel you even had it easier than, you know, than people before you, right? So kind of reminding people that. But you also mentioned that sense of belonging, which is really nice to be able to, you know, associate with people, you know, other Black people and what they've done, but then also in the greater group. I mean, that's one thing that I love about being in the Army was the most diverse organization in the world. And we all supported each other, all the time. And that was pretty amazing for me to see. And then when we went and deployed places, we, you know, blended right in and worked with people from other countries. So I really appreciate that. And sometimes it's hard, but I think that, you know, you definitely were a good example of that. And you went through, go ahead.
No, I was just going to say on that note, please excuse me but I was going to say on that note, I spent a great deal of my career in diplomatic assignments. So not necessarily on big bases overseas, but places where there were maybe four or five American servicemen. And I would tell you to that point, when other militaries and other military personnel look at us and they listen to us, we tend to sometimes accentuate our differences in this country. But I would tell you, when other people look at us overseas, I spent a lot of time in China where they used to say about the Americans, their skins are different, but their hearts are all the same. You know, I mean, and I thought, I remember thinking, what a profound.
Yeah, what a message. That's what I was thinking. What a message.
Exactly. What a message to Americans that their skins are different, but their hearts are all the same. So I didn't mean to interrupt, but I just wanted to mention to that point, that's the same thing I enjoyed about the military was the sense of family, the sense of belonging, and our differences were minimized because we have to depend. We had to depend on each other.
Yeah, I really that's a great message. I love that. And you know, so you mentioned some people, but are there any individuals from, you know, from Black history that really inspired you and influenced you on your journey?
Oh my goodness, yes. And I mentioned some of them, but they bear repeating. So as you know, I'm a West Point graduate, and so it was natural for me to look at some of my predecessors to West Point. And so I look at people like Flipper, the first African-American graduate of West Point, and the challenges that he faced in the 19th century. Colonel Charles Young, one of my personal heroes, because Colonel Young was this just amazing Renaissance man, was a writer, was a musician, played the piano, rose to the rank of colonel in the late 19th, early 20th century, was the only African-American regular army officer until Benjamin Davis graduated from West Point in 1936. Huh. They wanted to sideline him at the beginning of World War I because he was so senior. They would have had to have given him command, and to demonstrate his physical ability to continue in the army, he literally rode a horse from Wilberforce, Ohio to Washington, D.C. on horseback. Wow. In 1917 to prove that his physical ability to continue to serve, and then became one of the first Army foreign area officers, one of the first Army attachés. I was an attaché for four tours, and served then. So he was one of my great heroes. Of course, General Benjamin O. Davis, the Tuskegee Airman, who proved that African Americans were just as capable of operating aircraft as anyone else, who had to lead his organization, spent 4 years at West Point where nobody would talk to him. He was silenced, but nevertheless remained undiscouraged, came out of that and ended up being a principal and critical leader in helping to change not only the culture in the United States Army, but that culture, the culture of our nation. And not all my heroes are African-American. I'm a big fan of President Harry Truman. And I've read a lot of biographies on him. Of course, it was President Truman who desegregated the armed forces in 1948. But you have to understand who he was. He came from a Missouri family. They were very supportive of the Confederacy and the South during the war. But more than all of that, Harry Truman was a veteran. He was a veteran of the First World War. And when African-American veterans came back from World War II, and some of them were mistreated solely because they were trying to assert the rights that they had earned on the battlefield, it was President Truman who, despite his heritage, despite his family background, in the end, he supported his veteran brothers and sisters and helped desegregate the military and move the country forward. I'm a big fan of President Lyndon Johnson's. Again, another person who, despite his background and his heritage, and I know there's a lot of discussion about the type of person and politician he was, but nobody can dispute the fact that he passed the Civil Rights Act, passed the Voting Rights Act, and made it possible for all Americans to both express themselves and vote, but also to take advantage of the beauties of this country. So those are some of my heroes. I mean, I could go on all day, Rich, telling you about the people that inspired me to move forward, but those are some that I wanted to highlight.
No, I think that's great, and I like the fact that, you know, you're taking examples from everywhere you've seen and read and things of that nature, and so you had a long military career, very successful. So how do you think that's influenced you as a leader in the private sector?
Well, it's interesting you mention that, because, you know, just like all soldiers who are transitioning, and I'll talk a little bit about this later, but look, it doesn't matter whether you're a general or a private. When that ends and you're taking that uniform off, there's butterflies in your stomach, you know, and you're wondering, I had all these experiences in the military. Are they going to translate to in as I transition to civilian life and leave the military? And in terms of leadership, I will tell you that I had developed over the years what I call my nine non-negotiables. These are the fundamental tenets of my own leadership style. And I developed them over my 40 years, my over 40 years in the military. But I've been interested to find out that they're equally applicable in the private sector. And as a matter of fact, now one of the things I do is I teach executive leadership at the Booth School of Business at the University of Chicago. And I found it fascinating that many of the things I learned as a military leader apply equally in the private sector. So let me tell you what my nine negotiables are, okay? And these are the leadership and values principles that I internalized as a military leader that I still use now that I'm in the private sector. So the first one is loyalty. No surprises there. But loyalty is a two-way street. You have to earn the loyalty of your teammates and subordinates, okay? You have to earn their loyalty and be loyal to them in return. Honesty, okay? Being honest with those that you work with. And sometimes if the situation is difficult, you tell them, hey, the situation's difficult, but let's work together to overcome the challenges. Integrity is very important, that you say what you mean and you mean what you say. And as we say in the military, your audio, those things that you espouse, matches your video. In other words, your actions and how you conduct yourself. Discretion. I think it's important that leaders have discretion. Leaders are often privy to information about their teammates that is very private and very secret. And sometimes, you know, you keep that to yourself, but it helps explain why one of your teammates might be performing well or not performing up to their potential. Inclusion. Okay. And this is very important. And this goes back to what you said about in the United States military, we judge and assess people based on their merit and their qualities, not based on their race or religion or orientation or anything else. And we also accept information and advice from all quarters, sometimes from that person who you just don't get along with. Okay. So when I talk about inclusion, I always ask the person that always disagrees with me what they think about what I said. Okay. Because they might have a view that I hadn't considered. Common courtesy. Okay. Saying please and thank you. I tell people all the time, I was a general officer for 14 years and I don't ever remember using the phrase, and that's an order. Now, people only say that in the movies. You know, nobody says that in real life. You say, hey, can you get this done for me? Let's get it done, please. And you say, thank you. Common sense. Okay. This is a big one. And I learned this from, I told you all those veterans I grew up with, they were all NCOs, non-commissioned officers. They were all sergeants. Okay. And they taught me a lot about common sense. And I like to say I heard more stupid lieutenant stories before I was 15 years old than most people hear their entire lives. And so I said, well, I'm not going to do that stuff. Okay. Excuse me. And then the last two are really important. The eighth one is humility. Okay. I think all leaders have to have humility. And even in the private sector, sometimes you have to have the courage to say, I don't know, please help me or teach me. Okay. And you have to ensure that you remember that it's not about you. I can always hear my mother in my background saying, it's not about you, Charles. You know, it's about the team. It's about encouraging the team. And the last one, the ninth non-negotiable I have is courage, but not the kind of courage you think about on the battlefield, you know, rushing a fortified position or something. That's not the kind of courage I'm talking about. I'm talking about the courage to say, I don't agree with your boss, to tell your boss, respectfully, I don't agree with you, or to tell a superior, I'm not going to do that. That's wrong. Or to defend your team sometimes when they make a mistake. Not to hang them out to dry or throw them under the bus, but to say, it's not their fault. I'm the leader. It's my fault. And I'll tell you, all of those things, my nine non-negotiables I found are just as applicable in the private sector as they were when I was in the military. And that really frames my leadership approach and how I conducted myself then and how I conduct myself now in the private sector.
Well, that was a great list. I wrote them down. And again, I'm going to watch this over and over. But I agree with you. You know, all of these, you learn, you know, the military used to have leadership as an acronym for loyalty and duty and respect and all those. And a lot of these kind of intersect. And I like the fact that you can show that they relate to every walk of life, not just the military. And again, yeah, that we're not the drill sergeants are not the ones that are, you know, making these decisions. They're actually most of the military is this kind of conferencing and getting other people's opinion and doing the right things for everybody. So I appreciate that. And so I love that, you know, you also continue to serve, I think. And I didn't mention it before, but you are you know, on ACP's board as one of our advisors, and we really appreciate that. And you continue to serve in the private sector by trying to, you know, tell people what you've learned and share with them your experiences so they can maybe be better. So I really appreciate that. So thanks for that. And thanks for your advising us on the board. It really does help us guide the organization to help more people. So thank you for that. So can you share some pivotal moments in your military career that has a significant impact on your leadership style?
Yeah, there are. And as I said, in a 41 year career, there were many, but I've picked out four that I think I'd like to highlight that really helped me to become a better leader. And I think a better person. And I'll start out early in my career. In fact, the earliest part of my career. So I got to West Point and I finished up the summer training, the summer basic training, and the academic year was starting and it came time to pick a language. And in those days, West Point cadets had to take 2 mandatory years of language. And I had planned to take French because I took French in high school. And in those days, you stood in line at attention, you walked up to an upperclassman, they wrote down your language choice and turned it into the foreign language department. So I got to the front of the line and they said, "What language, mister?" You know, and I was standing there at attention with my chin back. And I said, "Sir, French." And he said, "French is full. Pick another language." Well, I learned a very valuable lesson that day that you got to have a plan B. I didn't have one. But I looked at the list of languages and Chinese language was on there. And so I told this upperclassman, "Sir, Chinese." And he looked up and for whatever reason, he said, "It's too hard for you. Pick another language." And I got very, very upset by that and very determined. And the long story short is we went back and forth a couple of times and I insisted on studying Chinese. And the last thing he said was, "It's your funeral." I remember him saying that. But it wasn't my funeral and it turned out to change my life. I concentrated in East Asian studies and Chinese language. Of course, years later, I went to study in Beijing as a student and spent 7 years in China, 3 different assignments in China, and it changed the course of my life. So that first lesson I learned about leadership was don't take no for an answer and don't let anybody discourage you or tell you what you can't do. So that was the first lesson. Second lesson was my first platoon and a man named Lieutenant Colonel Bob Jackson. And so I went to the 25th Infantry Division, 1st Brigade of the 25th Infantry Division, 1st Battalion, 19th Infantry, and I got there and I encountered my battalion commander, who was a guy named Bob Jackson. In those days, Hawaii was kind of at the bottom of the supply chain. Europe was the focus. This is long before Desert Storm and the China threat. But Bob Jackson was one of the most amazing leaders I had ever met. And no one would ever say that we were friends. No two people couldn't have been different. I was this kid from New York, New Jersey. He was from the hills of Tennessee. He liked both kinds of music, country and Western. We had very little in common personally, but Bob Jackson loved the Army and he was interested in developing talent and being a mentor to everyone. And despite the fact that we didn't have a lot personally in common, he painstakingly made me a better leader, a better tactician, and he gave me opportunities to perform a lot of jobs accelerated ahead of my peers. And he didn't have to do that. And years later throughout my career, Bob Jackson would pop up and he was the difference in many instances between getting me the job that I wanted, I was competing for and not. And I learned from that to mentor somebody, to be a teacher or mentor, you don't have to look like them. You don't have to have anything personally in common with them. All you have to do is care about the country, care about the organization and care about people and you can be a mentor to someone. And I owe Bob Jackson more than I can say. The third instance was stands out in my mind about my leadership is I served as the United States Defense Attaché to the People's Republic of China and the Defense Attaché to Egypt. And from those two experiences, I learned, and I was a junior attaché in China as well. I learned to see the world through someone else's eyes. Okay. To understand why people do what they do and why people feel the way they do by looking through the world at the world through their eyes. Well, why do they feel that way? And I found that as a leader, that helped me to better understand my team and my subordinates when I said, well, why are they doing this? Well, let me look at how they see the problem and how they see the world through their eyes. And so my time as an attaché, where I wasn't on a military base, I was one of maybe 4 or 5 U.S. military personnel at the embassy, it helped me to understand how other people view the world. And if you understand that, you can better relate to them. And then the last one is fairly recent, actually, and it came when I was a general officer. I was in charge of a large headquarters organization in Washington, D.C., and 20,000 people around the world. And I had significant responsibility for weapon sales to our allies and partners. And I found myself leading through COVID and trying to balance the needs of my people, the needs of the staff and the people in the organization with the mission and making sure everybody was protected. And I will say that experience leading through COVID, I had this organization, for example, where I had three people from three separate jurisdictions during COVID, Washington, D.C., Virginia, and Maryland. All three of them, as you recall, had different rules and things. And so I found myself trying to lead this organization and everyone around the world to continue our mission during COVID. And I discovered that there were other ways to get things done, and you had to have balance. And you really did have to balance between the mission and the welfare of the soldiers, sailors, airmen, Marines, and civilians that are your responsibility. So I could mention a bunch, but those four, I think, stand out in my mind is having influenced and shaped my leadership style and how I relate to people.
Oh, that's great. I love the story from back in the cadet days, because sometimes that type of thing is what motivates you when someone tells you can't do something. And then, the fact that you mentioned about mentoring, right? That's what I love about ACP is that we put two people in contact with each other, probably would never met each other any other time in their life, but they do, and they end up becoming lifelong friends and helping each other out, which is amazing. And then, I think I learned as you did a little bit while you were an attaché, when I deployed to Iraq, in the beginning, I remember having this thought, like, why won't they just do what we're telling them to do, right? Because I worked with training people and stuff. And then I kind of had that realization, like you're mentioning, is like, if you start seeing things through other people's eyes, you realize why they're doing things the way they're doing, and then how you can probably work with them to get them to do what you want them to do, or what you think is best for them, but through their methods. So I think that's important to, and that doesn't have to do with foreigners, right? Or people from other countries. That can be with your neighbor, right? Or someone that you're working with. So I think that's huge. So those are great, great lessons. And I think COVID taught a lot of people some lessons. So thank you for that. So you mentioned this a little bit earlier, but because we have a lot of people that are in their transition out there watching us, I wanted to hear from you, because I had the same experience. Like, people told me, you'll have no problem getting a job. I already retired as lieutenant colonel. I had a PhD. They're like, oh, no problem. I was panicking for quite a while and was really worried. So tell us a little bit about your experience, because I think it is tougher for someone with all your experience to figure out how you're going to fit into the civilian world.
Yep. And absolutely. And as I said, and you talked about it a little bit yourself, Rich, it doesn't matter whether you're a private E1 or a general O9. When I put on a uniform, I was 17 years old. Okay. It's the only job I ever had. And for many of our retiring veterans, transitioning veterans, it's the only real job you've had your entire adult life. So everybody's apprehensive. Everybody wonders whether the phone is going to ring again. And it doesn't matter whether you're a general or not. And I will tell you, first thing I want to say is, everybody take a deep breath. Okay. Relax. You'll be fine. I want to start out with that. Okay. You'll be fine. It'll be okay. Many, many others of your veteran brothers and sisters have preceded you, and they've done it. And if they've done it, so can you. It'll be okay. You have more job skills and you have more job skills and more resilience than you think. Okay. And the private sector out here recognizes some of the qualities that you have. Sometimes we need to translate and work on that, but you have the skills to be successful out here. Relax. The phone is going to ring. Okay. It'll be okay. And I think you can agree with that. So that's the first thing. Second thing I'd say is, and that I did, was do your homework. Okay. There's some fantastic resources out there that can help you think about transition. ACP, of course, is one of those. Okay. And go out and do some homework and find the resources that are out there that can help you with this transition. Because I'll tell you something, your veteran brothers and sisters and others out there, they're waiting to help you. It's just a matter of putting you together with them. Okay. So there are people out there that want to help you. So do your homework. Okay. Plan your transition. Start early thinking about your transition. And I know what you're going to say. I'm not retired. You know, we have the, you know, I'm not retired on active duty. I'm going to go 100% until the minute I take. I totally understand that. Remember, I'm the guy that spent 40 years doing it. Okay. But there's nothing wrong with taking some time to think about your transition. Okay. To kind of plan it out, to talk to your significant others, your partners, your family, your friends, about what you want to do and where you want to go. Okay. And that, and both of those, what you want to do and where you want to go, both of those are very important. So it's not being negligent of your duty to think about your transition. I remember my first platoon sergeant said, "Sir, one day this is going to end, even for the chief of staff. It ends one day." And he told me that when I was a young 22-year-old second lieutenant. He said, if you realize that now, you'll be okay when it finally happens. Okay. So I pass his wisdom on to you. Think a little bit about, you know, I know you know from your military career what you can do. Maybe now's the time to think about what you want to do. I mean, think about it. Okay. We spent our whole lives can do, sir. Get out there and get it done. Okay. Think about what you want to do, not what you can do. And the last thing I'll leave you with is don't be afraid, again, to ask for help and advice. There are people out there. ACP is out there to help you. There are others out there to help you. There are veterans organizations at many of the companies that are out there that can help translate what you've done into something that would be of interest to the companies that you want to work for. So I'd say don't be afraid to ask for help. It's going to be, and let me finish where I started. It's going to be okay, right? It'll take a little work, a little persistence on your part, but you're going to land on your feet and life's going to be good.
No, I think those are all great. And yeah, it does. Sometimes we need to hear that positive encouragement because, yeah, we forget that it's going to be over at some point and we all have to work through it. And we can. And there's a lot of, as you mentioned, a lot of resources out there to help people do that. So thanks for reinforcing that. So now, how do you hope that your contributions have influenced the next generation of leaders? So you've no doubt have been in charge of many, many people. And how do you hope that they viewed you?
Well, that's a good question. And I hope, again, to answer your question, that through not only things that I've said, but through the example of how I led, I hope that helped to inspire people to become their best. A wise mentor of mine once said in the early days, he said, you should always leave any organization, any group, anyone you're with, associated with, better than you found it. Okay? Better than you found it. And so I hope in big ways and small ways that I've been able, that I've been able to do that. I've been able to make people's lives better, to make the organizations that I've been with better. I feel very strongly about teaching, coaching, and mentoring. I used to tell people all the time, counseling is a management function. Mentoring is a leadership function. And the two are not the same, okay? And you should spend time, because I'll tell you the truth, okay? No one... When you're on active duty and you're working hard, no matter how high up you are, I always understood that no one would remember after maybe 2 weeks the last memo I wrote or what my rank was or all of those things. If you're remembered at all by the people you serve with and the people, it's the lives you touch. If somebody says, hey, you know what, General Hooper, that guy was okay. I learned X or Y or Z, or he taught me X or Y or Z, or he was a good leader. He was firm but fair, and he taught me to be firm but fair. And he showed me that you don't have to be a jerk to be a great leader. Okay. Or he showed me you can laugh at a joke and laugh at yourself and still be a good leader by not taking yourself seriously, but taking what you do seriously. So I hope through my actions and through the way that I've conducted myself, that I've helped to shape and influence the next generation. And the fact that I've taken very seriously the responsibility to pass on what I have learned. You know, kind of what ACP does when they help to mentor veterans that are transitioning, that I would pass on what I learned and in the hopes that it would help those coming behind me to perhaps step around some of those potholes and some of those obstacles that I tripped over or stepped on. I'm always mindful. One of my favorite sayings is, you know, that Commander Alan Shepard, of course, was our first astronaut, the first American into space. And there's an old story about how when he was being interviewed, they asked Commander Shepard, they said, Commander Shepard, before he went up the first time in Friendship 7, they said, Commander Shepard, are you a man of faith? And he said, yes. They said, do you pray, Commander Shepard? He said, I absolutely do. And they said, well, when you pray, Commander Shepard, what do you pray? And he looked at him and he said, I pray, please, God, don't let me mess this up. Okay, and the reason I say, and so throughout my career, because going back to the beginning, because I knew I was standing on the shoulders of giants, because I knew that many people had sacrificed to give me the opportunity to attend West Point, to give me the opportunity to study Chinese or to attend and graduate from Harvard University or to represent my country in China, represent my country in Egypt. All these people who had sacrificed and worked hard just to give me the opportunity to prove myself. And I was mindful that I did not dishonor them by wasting that opportunity, and that I built a legacy that others behind me, other Americans behind me, could take advantage of and could learn from. So I take all of that very seriously, and I hope through my actions and how I've conducted myself as a leader, that some little thing that I might have said or done might have inspired somebody else, and that when they get to the point where they serve as an example and a mentor, they will mentor others, they will pass on what they have learned, and the cycle will remain unbroken as we help to make each successive generation of leaders better. And if we do that, then our country will continue to grow strong and will continue to prosper based upon not the technologies we have or the military power, but the people that we've invested in.
I think that's such a great story. I'll tell you, I've seen a lot of Black History Month programming, but I think we just hit the best. What some great message, great learning experiences. Really loved talking with you today. I wanted to ask if you had any personal message or reflection that you'd like to share with our audience regarding the importance of this commemorative month.
Absolutely. So number one, dare to dream. Dare to reach for your dreams. Okay. If you had told me all those years ago that I would have had a chance to study Chinese or go to Harvard University or do any of those things, I would have said, you're crazy. But I dreamed that I could do it, and I was willing to reach for it, and I've received support. At the end of the day, I would tell you, number two, all you have in this world is your name and reputation. Okay? That's all you have in this world. So cherish them, protect them. And remember, when you walk out, you're representing your loved ones, your parents, your family, those who invested in you. If you try and fail, yeah, it'll hurt for a little while. But if you never try, you'll always wonder, what if? What if I had given it a shot? Okay? Don't let anyone tell you what you can do. Okay? Don't let anyone tell you that. Prove them wrong. Okay? Do your homework, put in the work, and prove them wrong. Keep your sense of humor. That first platoon sergeant, Sergeant Passy, the other thing he told me is, sir, this stuff doesn't seem funny sometimes. It is funny. And I've been laughing ever since, and it didn't hurt my career one bit. Mostly at myself. And the last thing I'll tell you is, in that, on that note, is believe in yourself. You can do what you want to accomplish. Okay? You can do it. All you have to do is believe in yourself, put in the work, and you can achieve your dreams.
That was great. And I would argue that, you know, those people that you mentioned that, you know, you stand on their shoulders and shoulders, and a lot of the successful people we look back on share a lot of those same things in common. So thank you for those messages. And as I said, mentioned, this is going to be one of those webinars that I'm going to keep referring people to, because so many great messages, especially during Black History Month. But I'll tell you, for any special occasion or just day to day, there's great messages there, and we really appreciate it. So thank you for taking the time to spend with us today. I really appreciate it, and have a great day. Thanks.
You too. And thank you so much for having me, and wishing everybody out there all the best.